Our goal in going through the whole tax plan, through the whole process, is not to get the client to a perfect place. You know, a lot of us come from a tax background. Some of us have been, not me personally, but you know, some of us have been in tax for 30 years. Some of us have never done a tax plan at all in this room. So there's a really wide range of background experience in here, different things that people have done. Some people are gonna understand, you're gonna hear everything, and we talk about all the strategies this week. You may not have heard the strategy before, but you're gonna understand them. They're gonna fit into your knowledge that you've already gained through doing taxes for a long time. Some people, you know, some of these are gonna make sense, and some of them may not make sense. That's okay, because you're not trying to learn everything. You're not trying to do everything for your client. The only thing you're trying to do for your client is get them from where they are now to a better place. That's the goal. We're not trying to get every single strategy. We're not trying to fix everything that we may see could be done for a client. We want to get the client from where they are now, you know, to a better place after having worked with us. And then, like Andrew said, we've got implementation. We've got, you know, if we learn a new strategy 3 months from now, we can implement that for them. We can go back to them and say, hey, you know what? I learned this new strategy, went to another conference. I think this would be a great idea for you to implement. I really think, you know, we should work together on this. Or, you know, upsell them into other services.
The strategy session is sort of a mirror of how the entire relationship is going to go, right? So if somebody comes in, well, why don't you just tell me what you do, right? Oh my gosh, who wants to even work with that person, you know? Worst case scenario, they sign up and then you have to like talk to them again. Right? Seriously. So what I like about this process is it's meant to weed out sort of bad people, okay? And so if they're acting crazy, if they're not following your process, probably when they become a paying client, they're gonna act crazy, they're not gonna follow your process. So, you know, if it's not going well, sometimes it does feel good to end the call, right? Sometimes, you know what, honestly, I appreciate, you know, you coming onto this or whatever, but I can tell you right now, based on how this call's gone, this isn't gonna work, and I honestly do wish you the best of luck. And when you leave, you feel like, I'm such a badass, and right? I told him, right? When you realize you're not gonna make the sale, right? Sometimes you realize you're not gonna make the sale, you wanna figure out how you can leave with your dignity, right? Because you gotta go to the next call, and you gotta feel like you deserve what's coming next. So even if you don't wanna let that person sit there and just abuse you for the rest of the call just because you happen to connect. So if you feel like it's going the wrong way, try to figure out a way to leave with your dignity, end it early, and let them know you're ending it on your terms so you feel good. So that way when you go into the next call, even though you didn't close that one, you still won. I always like to leave the calls feeling like I won, even if I did not close the deal. People have a fear of missing out, okay? They have a fear of missing out, and that is a lot more powerful than gain, okay? This is about, they've already missed out, and it's real, and it feels real. If you tell them that they lost out, that is gonna be more powerful than, hey, you can gain in the future. This seems fake. This feels real. I lost, I did lose it based on last year. They're analyzing, it already happened, right? If you tell somebody, I could save you $35,000 in taxes, not as powerful as you already lost this money. Right? It feels more real, and psychologically it's much more persuasive to the person, even though generally we can do less on it. So a lot of people think, well, look, I can't go back because none of these particular strategies that I know apply to the previous year, so I can't save the money in the previous year, so I don't want to bring that up because that's just bringing up stuff I can't even solve. And I like to focus on problems. I like to focus on problems I can solve, and I get that. But the reality of it is they will start freaking out if they believe this inside. Ugh. All right, because everybody hates paying taxes. And when they realize they overpaid for no reason, they start to get the feeling, it's just that deep, it's that pit. It's just, ugh, ugh. So it's so important that we do that. Now, if it's an existing client, like I said before, not the best thing to focus on. Fundamentally, tax planning is really education, almost. Because when you deliver the plan, you're teaching them the strategies. But if they want to implement, they're gonna have to do that on their own. A lot of times people will include checklists in their tax plans, they'll include like instructions for their existing accountant. And so one of the challenges that people get into is if you're just giving, and James, do you have the clicker? Here it is. Yeah, if you're just giving them the information, a lot of times they won't implement it. Like a lot of people we talked about, like with Boris and some other people where you send the tax plan, you send that recorded Loom, and they don't watch it, or they watch it but they don't implement it. And so one of the things I like to ask always is like, how do you get the best result for the client? How can we actually get them the best result? How can we actually get them to save the most money? And it really is a hybrid. It's more of a done with you model. So instead of just doing the tax preparation services, which is really the worst, or just doing the planning, we want to do planning, implementation, and preparation. And so you can see with tax preparation, obviously that's the lowest value. It's the compliance value, it's the lowest pricing, okay? When you move to tax planning, there's high value, but the problem is there's not the highest result. Like, there is high value in the plan itself, but there's a certain percentage of people that are going to drop off and they're not going to implement it, or they're only going to implement certain things, or they're going to implement something wrong. Okay, so it doesn't necessarily drive the highest result. And then when you add in planning, implementation, and preparation, it's all bundled, okay? You really provide the highest value. You get the highest result for the client because you're going to go through and you're actually going to help them do it. But even still, you know, the client has to come to the table, right? I mean, how many people in here have had a client where, like, no matter how much you try to help them, they, like, sabotage the whole situation, right? You know, it's like they just keep taking money out personally. They keep on borrowing more money. Like, you have to get to a point where you're coming to the table, but also the client's coming to the table. And so it's more of a done-with-you model than tax planning, which is almost training and information, and tax preparation, which is really services. Okay, the best way to get results for the client is when you're doing a little bit and they're doing a little bit. But that also kind of is where you can charge the highest investment, the highest amount of money, because really, if you're getting the client the best result, the most value is being created, you can build the biggest fee. Okay.
There's a difference between having a board meeting at your house and actually documenting the minutes and having a board meeting in a restaurant with your spouse. This is not what that's for. Do not go out to a fancy, swanky restaurant and have this great meal and expect that it's going to be deducted as a board meeting. That's not how it works, people. If you do that, it is not going to be a good thing if you get audited, okay? So, but if you do it and you document it and you make sure that you document that board meeting at your home, you're doing two things, like I said. You're taking advantage of the Augusta and you're making your company more safe.
So my book of business is all the month-end accounting, right? I know a lot of my clients' numbers, their books. Most of them need a tax plan. Some, I'm not so sure they need one. How do I get around that objection for myself? I mean, I have one lady in particular in mind right now, and Boris looked at it for me, and we feel like there really isn't anything we can do for her. But there's got to be something we can do for her. She wants to give money. She wants a tax plan. She wants to save money. She's a single person, no kids. I don't know how much money to get off of her and for Boris and I to go do more research.
But here's the thing. Let me tell you this. There's one problem with what she said. You're thinking too much about it before collecting the money.
I don't even know what to ask her for money. Like,
well, first thing is you need to ask for the money.
How much?
Right. So, like I said, at least $2,500 to $9,800. Now, I get it. Okay, I'm insecure. I'm not sure how much I can save her. I had Boris. The problem is you're involved in it. Boris is involved in it. We got no money.
I know. And she's ready. She wants to give me money. And I'm like, I just don't know what to do with her. Like.
Yeah. So I would say, look, and here's another
$3,500 might be too low. And then we're like, well, I don't even know what she's got in there that we can save her.
See, but you see, this is interesting, right? This is so interesting to watch.
Oh, we're supposed to wait till tomorrow?
No. I'm saying wait till tomorrow to go through the specific strategies, because that's not your problem. The problem is that for you to get another contracted person involved, for you to have a call, for you to ask about the person at a tax conference, I'm beating up on you, okay. You know, we want to get paid from that person first. So even if you don't know, just go with the $2,500. Because the thing is, in the beginning, like, your experience working with people is more valuable than the money you're going to make for your first 10 deals. Right, and I think that goes for any service. If you're starting a new service, your first 10 clients, like, even if you made $5,000 per client, you made $50,000, but you have that skill with you for the rest of your entire life, take the $50,000. Just like, can I just learn all that? And then I could capitalize on that forever. So charge her $2,500. In fact, call her after this, get the $2,500, and then we'll go over it tomorrow. But I think in order to go through a process of doing the investigation, you can't do it. So the worst thing you can do, and I already know some of you are doing it because we found one, but she's not the last one, I know. Right? You've already talked to the client. They've told you a little bit of things. You've had the conversation. You haven't collected the money, but you're doing the research, right?
Yes.
Wrong. You got to stop that. The whole purpose of a plan is to get paid to do the research. You're getting paid to plan, right? So, but if you're not getting paid, then you can't allocate your time to this. Now,
Puerto Rico and the USVI. Puerto Rico and the USVI are U.S. territories, but they're offshore, right? Let's be honest. They're not part of the continental U.S. The territories are interesting because it's kind of a hybrid. It's a compromise between the two. It's not really offshore because it's a U.S. territory, but it's not continental U.S., so it's kind of offshore. And so both of them have their own independent taxing that have created these incentives that say, if you come to our jurisdiction and you invest in businesses here or property here, or you're a resident here, we're going to give you some tax incentives. And these are massive tax incentives. Puerto Rico, 4% tax at the corporate level, tax-free on the profits coming out in dividends. Okay, 4% total tax. USVI, a 90% tax credit. So effectively the same thing. If you're at 37%, you're basically at 4%. So you're kind of looking at a 4%, 3 to 4% rate, entity and individual combined in these jurisdictions. Okay? That's real. You talk about incentive. If somebody's looking at a future of big income, you know, 5 years of big income before they sell or planning for the sale, this is a good device where you can go to these jurisdictions, you become a real resident, and you're getting these benefits for real. They used to give, hey, if it's medical travel for parents, business travels, okay, not now. Because of the abuse, if you want to take advantage of these, you're going to be there 183 days plus. Okay? And set up a real business and figure out, and when I talked about before of bifurcating businesses and you know, coming up with different restructures, you can take certain pieces of a business and take it offshore. That may be worth it to you, tax-wise, to go offshore, USVI or Puerto Rico, and do that.